Welcome everyone to AGI Live, Choosing the Right Conveyor featuring AGI High Roller and AGI Tramco. I would like to introduce our three panelists today. We have Jim Viss, is our Vice President of Engineering at AGI, Mike Spillum, our Sales and Marketing Manager at AGI High Roller, and David Wernsing, our General Manager at AGI Tramco and AGI Union Iron. Without further ado, I will pass it over to you, Jim.
Thank you, Paige, and good morning, everyone. Today's session of AGI Live will cover the factors influencing the proper selection of conveyor type for high-duty cycle commercial agricultural applications, followed by detailed product presentations of two of AGI's industry-proven brands of conveyors, AGI High Roller and AGI Tramco. AGI has hundreds of years of combined experience and history in the design and manufacture of conveyors of all types. This experience, combined with our extensive catalog, ensures a suitable selection for every commercial agricultural application. AGI manufactures six types of conveyors: enclosed belt conveyors, open belt conveyors, air-supported belt conveyors, on-mass chain conveyors, bulk flow chain conveyors, and screw conveyors. On this slide, you can see a representative cross-section of each type of conveyor manufactured by AGI. The upper left diagram shows the enclosed belt conveyor of the High Life design with its featured external bearings and enclosed carry-back UH&W line bottom. The upper middle diagram shows an open belt conveyor utilizing traditional SEMA troughing and return idlers. The upper right diagram shows the air supported belt conveyor. This conveyor utilizes a supply of low volume, medium pressure air to create an air film under the carrying belt and return belt. The result is a low friction carrying surface with no moving parts inside of the conveyor. The lower left diagram depicts an on-mass chain conveyor. This conveyor utilizes a welded barrel or roller barrel chain with welded attachments and bolted paddles with a minimal profile. The on-mass chain conveyor relies on internal product friction to carry product above the chain profile. In the lower middle, you can see a representation of a bulk flow chain conveyor. This conveyor uses a trough divided by a center plate and a chain with large profile paddles which fill the entire carrying chamber on the bottom. As a result, the bulk flow conveyor does not rely on internal product friction to convey, and product can be transported through bends and up to 90 degrees from vertical. The lower right diagram shows a screw conveyor. This type of conveyor uses a steel helix welded to a center shaft, rotating in a U-shaped trough. The helical shape results in forward transport of product, much like a wood screw pulls into the wall when rotated. There's several technical factors that influence conveyor selection. On the left-hand side, you can see the list of product bulk properties that influence the selection. They are density, friction factor on steel, moisture content, oil content, fragility of the product, and flowability of the product. There are also unique conveyor properties that affect the selection, such as capacity, length, incline, quantity and capacity of the inlets, quantity of discharges, and in-feed control, or the method that the conveyor is controlled. This table represents the effect of product bulk properties on conveyor selection. Starting with density, you can see that the effect of density is the same on all types of conveyors. It affects capacity and power in a linear fashion. The friction factor of the product sliding on steel has a minimal effect on belt conveyors, enclosed, open, and air supported. This is, of course, because the product is being carried by the belt, not sliding on the pan. However, it has a large effect on power for on-mass chain conveyors, bulk flow chain conveyors, and screw conveyors. specifically the function of density times that friction factor. Moisture and oil content are not recommended for enclosed belt conveyors or, pardon me, products with high moisture content and high oil content are not suitable for enclosed belt conveyors and air supported belt conveyors, but can be handled with open belt conveyors provided precautions are taken. Chain conveyors, bulk flow conveyors, and screw conveyors handle high moisture content product and high oil content product with minimal impact on the conveyor. In terms of product fragility, belt conveyors are very suitable to handle fragile products provided that the belt speed is managed. Chain conveyors on mass and bulk flow are okay for fragile products if the chain speed is managed. Screw conveyors are very poor for handling fragile products due to the pinch point that's created between the helix and the U-trough. In terms of flowability, it's difficult to handle non-free flowing products such as soybean meal or canola meal with belt conveyors. If the unloading is uneven, a metering device should be used above the inlet. Chain conveyors and screw conveyors, on the other hand, handle free flowing products quite well when the conveyors are equipped with properly designed inlets. In terms of the effect of conveyor properties on conveyor selection, you can see in this table that there are limitations for each type of conveyor for each one of the conveyor properties. Capacity, enclosed belt conveyors, we can reach up to 3,800 tons per hour. Open belt conveyors, 2,500 tons per hour. Air-supported belt conveyors, 2,000 tons per hour. Chain conveyors, both on mass and bulk, are generally limited to 1,000 tons per hour, and screw conveyors to about 300 tons per hour. In terms of length, enclosed belt conveyors, limited to about 1,000 feet. Open belt conveyors, about 2,000 feet or more. Air-supported belts, 1,000 feet. Chain conveyors, on mass style, limited to about 200 feet. Bulk flow chain conveyors, about 100 feet. And screw conveyors, about 50 feet. Those limitations are basically in place due to the power consumption differences, which you'll see coming up. But it's obvious from this table that if you're dealing with a very high throughput and long run, a belt conveyor is certainly the best solution, provided the product is suitable for a belt conveyor application. In terms of incline, belt conveyors, all three, can generally be inclined to about 10 degrees without cleats on the belt. An on-mass chain conveyor is limited to about 7 degrees to maintain capacity of a standard conveyor. There are improvements that can be made to increase that decline. Dave will talk about that a little bit more in his presentation. Bulk flow chain conveyor, as I mentioned, because of its unique design and the nature of the high profile paddles, can be inclined all the way up to 90 degrees from horizontal. Screw conveyors can be run at steep angles, but the most efficient angle to run a screw conveyor at is 25 degrees when inclined. In terms of the number of inlets, for belt conveyors, the distance between the inlets, the physical distance between the inlets basically governs in terms of skirt boards and in inlet design. For chain conveyors and screw conveyors, the number of inlets is virtually unlimited. Quantity of discharges, belt conveyors, generally speaking, limited to about 3 discharges with intermediate trips and the end discharge. Chain conveyors and screw conveyors, really just limited by space and carryover requirements. In-feed control, very critical for proper belt loading. And Mike will be addressing that very specifically in the high roller presentation. In-feed control for chain conveyors and screw conveyors, it is critical for meeting capacity and limiting overload. On this table, there's some relative metrics provided for power calculation, just to give everybody a flavor of the real difference in the drivers on the previous slide. If you look at the first example, the absorbed power or calculated power for a 200 ton per hour, 200 foot long grain conveyor with no incline, an enclosed belt conveyor consumes about 12.6 horsepower, an open belt conveyor 6.3 horsepower, an air-supported belt conveyor 6.2 horsepower, an on-mass chain conveyor sees a dramatic increase to 26.7 horsepower. A bulk flow chain conveyor would not generally be selected for a horizontal conveyor, and a screw conveyor 56.5 horsepower. The next row indicates the same application, however, for fertilizer products, not including potash. Here, you can see dramatically the impact of friction factor, the product friction factor on conveyor design. Again, we do not recommend handling fertilizer in any type of enclosed conveyor. So the enclosed belt conveyor and air-supported belt conveyor would not be recommended for fertilizer. However, open belt conveyors are commonly used, particularly for filling sheds. And the calculated horsepower is 6.3. And you can see there's no difference really in power for the same tons per hour between grain and fertilizer because it is moving on the belt. An on-mass chain conveyor of this application handling fertilizer would be 49.8 horsepower. Again, a bulk flow conveyor would not be used for a horizontal incline. And then over on the right, you can see a dramatic increase to 107 point horsepower for screw conveyors. The bottom three rows are just to give a general indication as to capital cost, operating cost, and maintenance cost of all types of conveyors. Capital cost on enclosed conveyors tends to be high. For open belts, moderate for chain conveyors, and quite low for screw conveyors. However, conversely, the operating cost of belt conveyors, particularly enclosed and open, is very low. The air-supported belt has a moderate operating cost due to the air systems involved. Chain conveyors also have a moderate operating cost due to the power requirements. And screw conveyors have the highest operating cost resulting from the highest power requirement. Maintenance cost, again, very low for belt conveyors, very few wearing parts when compared to chain conveyors, which are moderate, and screw conveyors, which have a very high operating cost due to the wear parts. The final most important factor affecting the cost of a conveyor is the speed at which it runs. Belt conveyors, chain conveyors, and screw conveyors, in all three cases, speed drives cost. The example I'm showing here of a 400 ton per hour, handling 400 ton per hour of grain at 180 feet per minute would require an on-mass chain conveyor trough size of approximately 18 inches by 18 inches. However, handling 400 tons per hour of grain at 90 feet per minute, chain speed requires a chain conveyor trough of approximately 24 inches by 24 inches. The net result of that, from a mechanical engineering perspective, is a larger drive, larger shafts, a heavier chain, and more steel, and about a 50% increase in cost. Speed should generally be dependent on product fragility and to some extent the duty cycle of the conveyor and the application. And with that overall summary and high level view of conveyor selection, I'd like to introduce Mike Spillum from AGI High Roller to give a more detailed review of our High Roller product line.
Thank you, Jim. As Jim mentioned, I'm Mike Spillum, sales and marketing manager for High Roller Conveyors for the past 25 years. I'd like to speak to you about the evolution of the enclosed belt conveyor, highlight a couple of our more popular models, and discuss some applications and considerations. In the late 70s, High Roller saw a need for a conveyor that would eliminate the emission of explosive grain dust and reduce housekeeping and maintenance costs. Also, the dust reduction would decrease the need for costly dust collection systems. As a result, High Roller developed and built our first enclosed belt conveyor in 1978. A few benefits of enclosed belt conveyors versus conventional open belt conveyors. The bearings are isolated from explosive grain dust. Personnel safety is increased. There's much less cleanup required around the conveyor and much fewer exposed moving parts. There's less product loss. Spilled product is reloaded back into the product stream. And housekeeping and dust collection costs are greatly reduced. A few benefits of enclosed belt conveyors versus chain conveyors. Horsepower requirements are lower. Maintenance costs are reduced. And product is handled more gently. The primary feature of the enclosed belt conveyor is the reloading tail section. The patented design was incorporated into the very first high roller and has been a key component to every conveyor manufactured since. It incorporates a telescoping take-up box with Acme-threaded tension and leveling rods. A hinged tail cover permits access to the reloading tail pulley. We also include provisions for safety monitoring. The tail section shown here incorporates an optional linear actuated belt tensioner, a heavy-duty top hinge, and V-wheel tail supports. The tensioner shown simplifies adjustments on higher tension conveyors. This style of tensioning system can also incorporate a load cell to provide you constant tension measurements. The V-wheels help to support the weight of the tail on conveyors with long take-up assemblies or on larger, heavier models. I'll explain the process of reloading. The red arrows depict the path of the conveyor belt as well as any spilled product. All dust and spilled product is returned to the tail section and diverted into reloading flippers located at the outer edges of the tail pulley. The flippers lift and direct material against a stationary deflector that directs the material back onto the carrying surface of the belt. Pictured are two of our most popular models. On the left is our high roller. On the right is our high life. We also have a few smaller models available, but my focus today will be on these two. The high roller was the original model. It achieves the trough support of the conveyor belt by using a spool-shaped carrying idler rotating on a single axis. The High Life utilizes a combination of horizontal and 45-degree idlers rotating independently. In both cases, the bearings are isolated from the internal atmosphere of the conveyor. The high roller idler has a full width internal pipe supporting it. Stub shafts are inserted into each end, which protrude through the sidewall and into the idler bearings. The short shaft allows for removal in confined spaces. When increasing the belt width with each model of high roller, we do not increase the depth of the trough. Because the larger spool and smaller center tube are rotating together, there's a slight slippage between the idler and the conveyor belt. The slippage is slight so that there's not much wear on the idler or belt. However, if we were to increase the diameter of the spool, the differential speed would increase, as would belt wear on the idler. The high roller model is available for capacities up to 57,000 bushels an hour or 1,500 metric ton an hour. Available with heavy duty options, it's suitable for most grain applications. The High Life model was designed to overcome a few limitations of the high roller model. As the belt width increases, the depth of the conveyor trough also increases. Therefore, more product can be conveyed on any given belt width versus the high roller. The flat idler of the High Life is supported much like the high roller idler, with the bearings, with a stub shaft protruding through the sidewall and the bearings mounted externally. The 45-degree idler of the High Life has two tapered roller bearings encapsulated in an internal can, which are permanently lubricated. The supporting shaft is fixed to an external bracket. The placement of the bearings under the product load reduces any overhung load on the bearing itself, as opposed to some designs of competing models in which the bearings are at the top end of the idler, and the weight of the idler and the product are at the lower end. Since the troughing idlers rotate independently of the horizontal idler, unlike the high roller, The increased depth of the trough does not result in any differential speed between the belt and the idler, thus resulting in a longer life idler along with the higher handling capacities. The high life conveyors available in capacities up to 140,000 bushel an hour or 3,800 metric ton an hour. They're suitable for port facilities as well as high throughput grain elevators and processing facilities. High roller and closed belt conveyors can be used in a variety of applications. I'm going to highlight some of the more common types. Reclaim tunnels under storage are a common application. With multiple feed points, dust is easily contained, keeping things clean and safe within the tunnel. Storage fill conveyors are also popular. The belt and product are protected from the environment, resulting in reliable use in any weather. Multiple silos can be filled utilizing individual piggybacked conveyors and two-way valves, or by using a single conveyor with multiple stationary trippers. Within storage buildings, we also offer open top conveyors with movable trippers or movable plows. The enclosed bottom prevents cross-contamination should your building have individual bays containing differing products. The feeding of products into processing plants is often done at lower capacities. Some may feel a chain conveyor will suffice. However, if used 24 hours per day, the cost of operating and maintaining an enclosed belt will be far less. Today's receiving pits are much cleaner than those in the past. Grain emissions are vastly reduced when receiving product from truck or rail. The high rate of conveying when loading barge, rail, or ship lends itself to the use of belt conveyors. Our conveyors are in use at nearly all port facilities in the US as well as many overseas. We have also adapted our conveyors to be installed on many different brands and styles of ship loaders. Our customers specified the need for dust control while loading vessels. Enclosed belt conveyors can also be used in reversing applications. Because our conveyor is designed to reload any returned product, we incorporate many features to reload the material back onto the belt as opposed to it dropping out the opposing discharge. Bidirectional inlets are also incorporated to get the belt loaded evenly in the direction of belt travel. Our enclosed belt conveyors were originally developed for handling grain products, which continues to be our primary industry. The grain dust is a natural lubricant for the returning conveyor belt over the anti-static UHMW return liner. The enclosed design has also worked well for handling other dry, dusty, granular products, such as absorbent clay, which is found in floor dry, or kitty litter. We do not recommend them for moist, warm, abrasive, or sticky product. Warm product can result in condensation, which will cause product to build up, causing belt slippage and tracking issues. Abrasive product can cause wear on the belt and return idler, the return liner. It's important that you communicate all products which you intend to convey when discussing a conveying solution. Speaking of communication, we pride ourselves on our relationships with our customers. We think of ourselves as much more than an equipment supplier. On some marketing materials, we refer to ourselves as problem solvers. Beyond the questions of product handled or desired capacity, we want to understand the type of facility you are operating and the throughput. Are you a seasonal facility or do you operate 24/7? In retrofit applications, there are often obstructions or other obstacles that must be overcome. We have incorporated many custom features in past projects to address these issues. Also, what are your future plans? We've sold conveyors to a customer 1 year. The next year they call and want to extend that conveyor. Perhaps they want to speed up and increase the capacity of the conveyor. We want to have the conversations now so that when we can recommend the proper equipment to meet your future needs, we which will save you time and money as you pursue your expansion projects. There's now various imitation enclosed belt conveyors being manufactured throughout the world. This is a testament to the successful product that we created. What Hyroller brings to the table is experience. I like to think that while we may have made occasional mistakes over the past 40 years and learned from them, our competition is making those mistakes today. It goes back to communication with the customer and getting involved in the planning stages. For example, enclosed belt conveyors operate at higher tensions than a conventional conveyor utilizing return rollers. Therefore, if a gradual incline is required, we calculate that incline to assure that the belt will lay down in the trough while starting up empty. If the belt is not properly seated in the idlers, it will not run straight. Loading becomes more difficult, resulting in uneven belt loading and belt misalignment. You've likely seen a conveyor belt lift off of the idlers of a conventional open belt conveyor. Picture that on an enclosed belt conveyor with covers above. Damage could be done to the belt in an instant. This is just one example of the thought process that goes into the design of an installation. Experience or lack thereof could make or break a project. Regarding the loading of product onto the belt, this is the area where I feel most mistakes are made. If a conveyor tracks empty, it should track under load. However, too often we hear of tracking issues when loading at different flow rates or from different infeed spouts. Our inlets are designed to introduce product onto the belt in the direction of belt travel. During the approval drawing process, we will work with you to assure the proper sizing and orientation of spouting and metering gates. When we quote or sell a conveyor, we assume that we will be customizing the inlets. There's nothing scarier than someone saying, just send me your standard inlet, we'll make it work. We want to work things out with you before the equipment gets to the job site. In addition to the customization of inlets, Hyroller also offers many additional options intended to complement your installation. Regarding belt loading, beyond the custom inlets, we also offer many integrated electric or manual slide gates. Our inlets will match the full flange of the gate. Therefore, any dust escaping from the slide gate will fall into the conveyor rather than onto the conveyor. We also manufacture much longer ladder gates to match up to truck or rail receiving hoppers. For discharging product, I previously mentioned utilizing two-way valves for cascading conveyors. Our two-way valve is custom designed to match the trajectory of the discharging product. It requires less conveyor elevation than if you were to use a conventional two-way valve positioned underneath the discharge. An advantage of the intermediate discharge tripper is that the conveyor remains horizontal on a single catwalk, whereas piggyback conveyors often require cascading catwalks for proper access to the conveyor. The stationary trippers have some limitations as to the number used on each conveyor. We typically like to see a maximum of 3 intermediate discharge points. At very high capacities, I prefer the piggyback approach. The size of the tripper, their pulleys, shafts, and bearings can get very large and heavy. I also previously mentioned movable trippers and movable plows for filling a flat storage building. The plows are lighter weight and work very well for most grain products. For smaller products such as canola or meal products, I'd recommend the movable tripper for a more positive discharge. These days, you can't hear enough about safety in grain facilities. We have always recommended the use of monitoring equipment. Bob Reese of CMC will be speaking on the topic of hazard monitoring in a separate presentation today. I highly recommend that you sign up for this. Thus, I will not go into a lot of detail on this important subject. However, at a minimum, we want to see a motion sensor and a plug switch installed on the conveyor. The motion sensor will alert you to belt slippage should the belt stretch. Proper belt tension must be maintained to prevent damage to the belt or breakdowns. A plug sensor should be installed at each discharge location. If the following piece of equipment should shut down or back up with product, our plug sensor will shut down the conveyor prior to plugging. Belt alignment sensors will alert you to an unevenly tracked belt. And bearing temperature sensors will monitor and alert you to any increases in bearing temperature. As you can see in the photo, we also incorporate guards around our head and tail shafts and drive couplings. For some specific customers, we will incorporate other safety features to meet their own internal guidelines. With the limited time available in this presentation, I hope to have educated you as to some of the basics of enclosed belt conveyors in our product line. I would encourage you to reach out directly to High Roller in the early stages of your product planning. We can then go into much greater detail regarding your specific requirements. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. I want to remind the audience to take full advantage of the chat function and submit your question to our panelists. Finally, we have David Wernsing, who will walk us through AGI Tramco's conveyors.
All right, thanks, Paige. Thanks, Mike. So Tramco was established in Wichita, Kansas in 1967 by Leon Trammell. The roots of the company lie in supplying material handling solutions to the soybean crushing industry and commercial elevators. But over the past 50 years, Tramco supplied tens of thousands of conveyors all over the world to the biggest names in the grain handling and processing industries, including Cargill, ADM, Louis Dreyfus, Bunge, countless others. As it's grown, it's spread out into other industries, including milling, food processing, and rendering, and has a very large and growing presence in the biomass and ethanol industries. Tramco specializes in chain conveyors operating in a continuous use environment, with a high percentage of the conveyors being engineered to each specific application. Its core product lines, which we'll cover today, are the G model and mass chain conveyor, the bulk flow divided pan chain conveyor, the model RB round bottom chain conveyor, and the jet belt, which is an enclosed air supported belt conveyor. The G model is Tramco's flagship product line. It's an N-mass style chain conveyor suitable for bulk material handling applications that require the horizontal movement of product and applications that require shallow inclines. Material can be fed into the conveyor anywhere along the conveyor between the head and the tail and in multiple locations. Similarly, material can be discharged via gates at any point and in multiple locations. Material is moved in the conveyors with heavy-duty chain that is spec'd and sized for the material and the application. Tramco uses a variety of standard chain types that include engineered class, WH series offset sidebar welded mill chain, steel bush chain, and drop forge chain. Stainless steel chain and chain components are common in corrosive environments. All Tramco standard chain is made in the USA. We'll typically use UHMW flighting, which is ultra-high molecular weight plastic that is attached to the chain with a variety of attachment brackets, depending on the requirements. Common attachment types include bar, angle, and formed V-cup. Tramco manufactures the majority of its sprockets in-house, and all Tramco manufactured sprockets are flame-hardened. The conveyor housing and liners can be constructed of different types of materials depending on requirements, abrasiveness, and the operating environment. The intermediate section end flanges are constructed of angle iron and are fully welded. Intermediates and covers can be gasketed and the entire conveyor is dust tight. We use packing gland seals for the shafts. For easy maintenance and service, the head and the tail are split so the bearings, shaft, and sprocket can be removed as a single assembly. Power transmission components are heavy duty and size very conservatively for continuous use. We use pole block bearings and can accommodate most drive configurations and brands, including shaft mounted belt drives, concentric reducers with chain and sprocket final reduction, and direct drives. Tramco has a continuous powder coat line in-house, but we can accommodate hot dip galvanized and custom wet paint requirements. We can also accommodate food grade applications when needed. The Tramco bulk flow chain conveyor is Tramco's most versatile conveyor. With taller flighting, in a pan that divides the carry side and the return side. The conveyor can elevate product at almost any angle in either a straight incline or with a combination of curved, straight inclined, and horizontal sections. When required, material can be carried in both the upper and lower chambers. We often see bulk flow chain conveyors used in high capacity receiving application when material is being moved from a below grade receiving pit for truck or rail unloading to a bucket elevator inlet. In this application, we usually see relatively high chain speeds and bend sections between 25 degrees and 60 degrees. Bulk flows are also commonly used in process to elevate product to load and unload processing or milling equipment where bucket elevators can't be used. In those applications, we typically see much slower chain speeds and heavier construction required for continuous use. In applications where bulk flows are feeding processing equipment, we often see requests for no liners and heavier sides constructed of abrasion-resistant steel. End flanges on the bulk flows are laser cut for a more precise fit to reduce the risk of alignment issues in the field. Bulk flow and Model G conveyors are pre-fit, match marked, and roll pinned aligned before leaving the factory. Tramco also has a line of vapor tight conveyors that are used to unload soybean meal from extractors in the crushing process. Similar to the Model G, the bulk flows use a variety of construction material, coatings, chain, flighting, and drive types depending on the particular application. As seen here, bulk flows can be configured in standard straight inclines with no bend sections, L paths with a single bend section, or S paths with multiple bend sections. We can also custom design loop conveyors and split housing conveyors to accommodate exotic loading and unloading positions. I'm not going to go into great detail on every option and accessory, but Tramco's G model conveyors can accommodate just about any custom request, including hazard monitoring and safety equipment like shaft speed monitors, chain brake switches, plug switches, and bearing temperature sensors. In applications that require intermediate discharge gates and head gates where material can carry over an intermediate discharge gate, we can add return cups to carry material back to the tail or brushes to clean the chain. Some applications require a higher degree of cleanout, so high tolerance or wiper flights can be added, as well as contoured heads and tails. As an example of how customized some of these options can be, we have even added hinged bottoms to conveyors so they can be opened up for frequent deep cleaning. All Tramco conveyors can be equipped with a variety of inlet and discharge gate styles. In applications where material is being control fed to the conveyor, a standard feed-through inlet is sufficient. These inlets can be located and mounted in the factory or in the field. In applications where material is not being control fed into the conveyor, Tramco can design a custom bypass inlet or feeder box to regulate flow into the carry side of the conveyors. Discharge gates come in a variety of styles, mounting arrangements, and operators. Again, discharge gates can be factory located or field located. Similar to the Model G conveyors, the RV drags and N-mass style chain conveyors suitable for bulk material handling applications that require the horizontal movement of product and applications that require shallow inclines. Unlike the Model G conveyor, the RV drag is constructed with a round bottom versus the flat bottom used in the Model G conveyor. That's where it gets its name, RV equals round bottom. The RV drag is normally used in applications where there is a higher level of cleanout required. RV drags are common in milling applications or when conveyors are used to handle multiple commodities and cross-contamination needs to be minimized. The RV drag is constructed of standard SEMA U-trough, and Tramco can convert existing SEMA U-trough screw conveyors into RV drags by constructing new heads and tails and adding the chain assembly and chain return system. Like the Model G conveyor, material can be fed into the conveyor anywhere along the conveyor between the head and the tail and in multiple locations. Similarly, material can be discharged via gates at any point and in multiple locations. Like the Model G conveyor, the RV drags use a variety of construction material, coatings, chain, flighting, and drive ties depending on the particular requirements. And RV drags can also be used in food grade applications. the options and accessories that are available are very similar to the Model G conveyors. The Tramco JetBelt is a totally enclosed air-supported belt conveyor. It's designed to convey dry, free-flowing product where dust containment is critical. Rather than using idlers or rollers to support the conveyor belt, the belt is supported by a layer of air that is pumped into a plenum below the belt. Because there are no idlers required to support the belt, there should be lower expense associated with maintenance of the conveyor. Horsepower requirements are similar to conventional belt conveyors. We normally like to see jet belts used in very long runs, greater than 500 feet, with a single inlet and single outlet. Like the high roller conveyor, jet belts are equipped with a reloading tail pulley to allow material that makes its way to the tail to be reloaded onto the belt. But this is less effective on a jet belt due to the vulcanized belt splice. Since there is no mechanical splice protector and the belt is lifted off the return pan with an air film, material isn't as aggressively pulled to the tail like it is in a high roller. For this reason, jet belts will typically use additional measures like brushes, air knives, or scavenger chain conveyors to clean the belt as it comes around the head pulley. Dust collection in the head section is important, and there must be adequate airflow to make sure dust and material is not pulled into the return side of the conveyor. Like all Tramco conveyors, the head and tail are designed for easy access and maintenance. This diagram shows how the air flows in the jet belt. It's basically a closed loop system. Air is pulled out the carry side of the conveyor and filtered with an AGI or Lanco dust collection system. The filtered air is then pumped into a plenum. There are small holes in the pan at the top of the plenum that allow air to lift the belt. A tube from the plenum bleeds off enough air to also support the return side of the belt. In some applications where a totally enclosed belt conveyor is not required, the air-supported return can be replaced with conventional idlers. Tramco recently supplied the material handling equipment for a pea protein processing plant located in Iowa. Tramco supplied a 12x8 bulk flow L-path conveyor with multiple inlets for rail receiving, a long 12x6 bulk flow L-path conveyor with a discharge height of 26 feet, and a short 12x12 Model G conveyor to transfer peas from the rail receiving. A 12x12 Model G with multiple discharges was used for filling the hopper tanks, and a very long 12x6 bulk flow S-path conveyor with a discharge height of 55 feet was used for reclaiming the pea storage hopper tanks and transferring them to process. All the conveyors were handling split peas and were spec'd food grade. They were all operating with relatively slow chain speeds, all between 50 and 60 feet per minute.
Thank you, David. At this point, I would like to open it up to your questions. The first one, Mike, this is for you. You made a reference to reversible conveyors. Can you explain the changes required to make these conveyors reversing and still be able to reload material?
Yes. There's a number of considerations. If it were simply to stick a discharge on each end of the conveyor, because our conveyor is designed to return spilled product, that material would simply discharge out the opposing end. So we incorporate a reloading valve on each end, typically linear actuated. When conveying in one direction, the valve would be opened up and the opposing end would be closed. So the opposing end would act much like our standard tail section and reload any returned product. When you reverse it, you open the opposing valve and close the other. But there's also a number of other considerations. I mentioned bidirectional inlets. It's important to get the material going in the direction of belt travel. Belt tensioning. Our standard conveyor, I mentioned the telescoping take-up box. So on a reversible belt, you're moving that discharge. So we will incorporate a discharge hopper with a stationary hopper with a sliding cover. So as you tension, you are always discharging into that hopper, which would be connected to your fixed spouting. Also, because you're moving that pulley further away from the idlers that are supporting the belt and the product, we don't want to get that span too great, so we'll often incorporate a troughing idler inside that take-up box. So as it's extended, you're still supporting the product and not creating any spillage at that area. And those are just a few of the things. There's a few more internal things. There's a discharge plow on each end that will direct material into the reloading vanes on the outer edges of either terminal pulley. And then that V-plow that we have in there is constructed such that as you reverse that belt, it's not trapping material. It's actually got a staggered front on it. So those and a few other things are all tied in together to successfully reverse and reload product.
Great, thanks, Mike. Jim, I have one for you. How do you address corrosion issues in the manufacture of conveyors?
Sure, thanks, Paige. There's several approaches we can use to the finish on virtually all of our conveyors. The first one, though, is, of course, understanding the application completely in terms of all the products to be handled, the ambient temperature and location of the conveyor installation, whether it's outside or inside. If it's inside, is it in a heated facility? What is the moisture content of the product? All those things play a very critical role, understanding that before you begin. In terms of finishes, we've got the ability to offer a powder coated finish, including a double application of that type of finish. We have liquid paint options on some products, including marine environment liquid paints. Galvanization is a very common answer to corrosion issues, especially in port facilities, and that's generally accomplished with a combination of hot dip galvanized components and in some cases pre-galvanized sheet components, depending on whether there's welding operations on the component after. And then of course, stainless steel is an option. Virtually all of the fertilizer handling equipment, for example, that AGI manufactures is the housings and casings of the equipment are manufactured from 304 stainless steel. And that option is available for any application, even processing ones, if it's a very high moisture or high temperature application where corrosion may be a concern.
Great, thank you. David, this one is for you. Is there a maximum degree of incline you recommend for your G model and mask chain conveyors?
We typically see the MS style chain conveyors applied in applications that require angles of 5 degrees or less. That really requires very minimal change to the design of the conveyor. Depending on the application, we might choose to speed the chain up slightly to compensate for any rollback. Greater than 5 degrees, we often see requirements, but between 5 and kind of 14 degrees, we'll definitely take mitigating action to an aggressive action to compensate for rollback and lost capacity. We'll do that by, once again, increasing the chain speed even further, increasing flight height. We can also increase the box size and actually assume a lower grain depth in the box due to the incline. So just generally speaking, in a normal application, up to 5 degrees requires a minimal change to the conveyor design. Between 5 and 14, 15 degrees, we would need to really design for the application. And of course, any incline at all, depending on the length of the conveyor and the feet of rise, is going to affect horsepower.
Thank you, David. Mike, I have one for you. What type of conveyor would be best for commercial seed growers, as cross-contamination is a serious problem?
High Roller specifically doesn't have much experience in that area, but I would recommend more of an open type belt conveyor or something with an open bottom, because cross-contamination is obviously a serious concern. And chain conveyors and enclosed belt conveyors. Because of the enclosed nature, there's better chance of carry back. Our enclosed conveyors are designed to return spilled product and reload it back onto the belt. And with fine seed and whatnot, you're trying to avoid that contamination. Probably the only thing we could do on our conveyors would be the possibility of a enclosed bottom, but an open tail section, so that you're eliminating the spillage, but you're not giving it an opportunity to get it reloaded back onto the belt. You'd probably want to discharge it out the other end, but open belt conveyors are probably a more common application than with certified seed handling.
Thanks, Mike. Jim, I have one for you. As a client, energy efficiency is now an important area, important criteria in the procurement process. How do you address such issues?
Thanks, Paige, and thanks for the question. Yes, it is a growing concern in a lot of our markets, particularly those with high energy costs. Really, again, this starts with the right conveyor selection. Provided the application is appropriate for any sort of belt conveyor, a belt conveyor will always be the most efficient conveyor from an energy consumption point of view. So that should be the first choice, provided again that it's suitable for the products being handled. With all of the conveyors, the other two most important factors are going to be the motor and drive selection. With respect to motors, really in most regions, premium efficiency or very high efficiency motors are mandated by code. But even when they're not, that should always be a consideration and the first choice, because there's a small premium for a premium efficiency motor, cost premium, but it's easily paid off. The other biggest factor influencing efficiency is the gear drive itself. Direct gear drives have a higher efficiency, overall efficiency, than say a belt driven gear drive, where there's an efficiency loss through the belt drive and again through the gear drive. So using direct drives in combination with premium efficiency motors, and then there are things the customer can do on their end with respect to soft starters and VFDs to minimize the demand on startup. But that's probably actually a bigger contributing factor than the previous three. But again, belt conveyor selection if possible, and premium efficiency motors and gear drives are what AGI will look at on every application where energy efficiency is a consideration.
Great, thanks, Jim. David, this one's for you. What's the typical chain speed you use?
Well, it really depends on the application. In commercial grain handling, we typically like to see chain speeds around 150 feet per minute. That can range from 125 up to as much as even 175 feet per minute. In processing applications and continuous use, 24-hour day, 7-day-a-week applications, we normally like to see much, much lower chain speeds. You know, 50 feet per minute would be very common. And then depending on the material and you know, how gentle handling the equipment needs to be, it's pretty common to see non-commercial grain, non-processing applications in that 100 feet per minute or less.
Great. And Mike, are cleated belts used, and what project requirements guide you to specifying a cleated belt in your belt conveyors?
Yeah, they are used. When we talk about cleated belts, we don't talk about, you know, the 2 or 3 inch high profile cleats. Our cleated belts would be chevron type, the V's you see going across the belt, or we commonly use what's called a mini bucket top. It's got about a 3/8 inch raised surface to help grab the product. So there's going to be project specific areas and when and where you use a cleated belt. But in generalities, you know, we say a smooth belt to 10 degrees and a cleated belt after. But there's more to it than that. You know, you can You can load at a lesser angle, so you're loading at 8 degrees and then gradually turning up and conveying 11, 11 and a half, you know, degrees. So it depends where you could still get by with a smooth belt. Alternatively, you could be at 8 degrees with terrible loading, and we incorporate a cleated belt to help grab that product. But the cleated belts, like I say, if you figure starting at 10 degrees, we, with that style belt, we convey probably to a maximum of 18 degrees. And with every increase in angle, even though it's helping to grab and convey the product, we are down rating our capacities. So if you were to look at our capacity chart and consider a horizontal conveyor with a smooth belt and look at that capacity, you turn that conveyor up to 18 degrees with a cleated belt, and you know, we might size it at 65% or 70% of what you see on the horizontal, but definitely they're used commonly on our conveyors for incline applications, and it just depends on the application itself on when we use them.
Great, thanks, Mike. I want to thank again our panelists, Jim, Mike, and David, for participating today in AGI Live. And thank you for joining us today. As an attendee, you have an exclusive access to the AGI virtual showroom featuring 360 degrees interactive AGI equipment and digital facility tours.